When the daylight comes, do you feel it? Leave your bag off.
We all came into this project with a general idea of what graffiti and street art were.
We all came from different states interested in art and hope to see it on our voyage.
What we learned superseded our expectations and ultimately changed the way we define street art and graffiti.
We hope to discover how different countries and cultures perceive street art and graffiti.
Through exploring the urban landscapes and meeting various artists, we were able to see that a clear difference exists separating the two.
No, we're never gonna talk about it.
Begin our journey in the streets of Galway, Ireland, where the street art became apparent almost immediately. Upon walking off the boat, we ran into an old abandoned lot that was walled off by the city of Galway. However, the walls only acted as a medium for artists to paint on and had little effect of keeping them out of the lot. The most intriguing scene was the image of how the city once painted over the wall of graffiti and art, only for it to be repainted by other artists. The art we saw wasn't just territorial graffiti, but was a whole collage of different artists painting over what they believed was just a blank canvas for their art. The bright neon colors with the black background made the art stand out among the dark and gloomy background of docks, factories, and apartments. The reasons behind doing street art are varied. Some artists are subversive and are trying to reclaim the streets. Other artists choose to paint about political or social problems, while some artists strictly do art because they see the city as a blank canvas. While in Dublin, we came across a whole city block that featured graffiti and street art alike. By itself, graffiti can be seen as vandalism, but when a whole city block is covered inch by inch, it's something extraordinary to see. Later in our travels, we would find out that techniques, ideas, and styles transcended borders into other countries, even continents. Many professional street artists travel to different countries to spread their art and techniques around the world. We have found out during our journey that the street art we found can beautify an area that would otherwise be a blank wall, shut down factory, or highway overpass. Street art is just like any art you'll see in a museum or art gallery today. However, the artists use the city as their medium, which in some cases makes their art that much more beautiful and moving.
Our stop in London, England proved to be a fruitful one. We found ourselves in London's East End. The East End is the home of famous designers and is London's unofficial capital for art, fashion, music, and culture. The famous Brick Lane and Spitalfield Market all make up the East End. It is a known center for both art lovers and artists alike. The urban landscape of the East End was just as eclectic as the crowd that gathered there. And the same could be said about the graffiti and street art that surrounded the area. From wheat-pasted doors to art installations, mural-sized stencils, and hyper-realistic portraits, the East End was filled with great works of art and vibrant colors. One street after the other, we were able to find some great pieces. However, we really struck gold when we came across an artist finishing up a piece he had started earlier that day. We took some time to get to know Ben and ask him about his craft and his experience as a street artist in London, and talked a little bit about the London street art scene.
Talk a little bit about London art in general, like how long have you been in the area, what you think of it, just give us a little rundown.
Yeah, I mean, I've lived in London now, well, came back to London about 8 years ago, okay. I've been doing street work for about three. And I mean, yeah, I mean, it's a great scene, there's obviously so many different styles and ideas floating around. It's got, people are doing it for various reasons now, not all that I agree with. It's getting quite commercial in ways, but you know, there's good and bad sides of that. But yeah, I mean, there's so many good artists, it's always a fun place to be,
right,
and to be inspired by so many folks.
Because it was such an artistic area, Ben loved the collection of artists that would gather and pass through, leaving work behind and bringing something new to the location. Some of his fellow artists that had work in the East End were all from all over Europe. All had different styles, but were unified by the idea of beautification and expression. We wanted to know what the motivation behind his artwork was, and what his work meant to him.
What do you bring?
I mean, mine. I've always done portraiture. I mean, that's kind of what people know me for. I guess that kind of realistic stuff. But I try to tell a story with a lot of my work. Not all of my work, but a lot of my work. And I'd like to think that with what I do, it is very sensitive to where it's going up. It's not just about turning up and painting. It's about relating to that area and doing something that's going to improve that area, not just turn up and do your thing, you know, right. Something that's has got something to say.
Okay.
It's based on, I'm just doing portraits of people based on their area, so it's not just here, but it's going to be all over the world, the people that have contributed to an area or right. a character that everyone knows. So this is Sandra, and she's the landlady up at the Golden Park Park, which is just up the end there, and she has been for about 35 years.
Very cool. Wow. Okay.
Ben's art combines subject matter that is pertinent to an area, and not just in his local neighborhood of London, but his project would be moving worldwide to different countries. With the hope that his art will pay homage to important figures, he chooses a public canvas. However, his expression is more than just a string of colorful words, but rather a personable rendering in an environment associated with the subject. This begs to ask the question, what sets street art apart from graffiti?
Okay, so street art versus graffiti. Is there a difference? What do you
think? Massively. You know, they're both very linked. I mean, for one, I don't think you wouldn't have street art if you didn't have graffiti, for right. one, just with the use of the spray can things, but they have gone very separate ways. Mm-hmm. And you know, there's some amazing graffiti artists and there's some amazing street artists. There's a lot of different things going on. Some graffiti artists say take real issue with street art and whatnot, but on the whole, it's a nice divide. It's a divide also that in many ways is coming together slowly, but it's certainly an interesting one. You could talk about that for a long time.
Right.
Ben believed that the difference between graffiti and street art existed in the motive or meaning behind a piece. One that expressed particular importance or had significance behind it would be considered street art, while scribbles and lettering would be classified as graffiti. However, the defining line separating the two is easily blurred. And with good reason, both exist in a realm of their own beauty. A beauty not only justified by their aesthetic value, but ultimately in the eye of their beholder. Our trip to London's East End taught us a few things. We learned that there is a connection between graffiti and street art. They go hand in hand. Without one, you could never have the other. Between them, there is an even bigger separation. This separation divides not only the work, but the artists that do them. However, Ben Slow is one of many artists who recognize the connection, yet embrace both types of work for what they are, expressive and communicative creations of art.
During our stay in Amsterdam, we saw a continuation of popular styles and found a pioneering establishment serving the global street art community. This store has built its reputation from a small paint distributor to a well-known provider of artistic supplies to visionaries around the world. It was in this location that we met the clerk, learned his take on street art's development, and came to understand Amsterdam's position in the culture. An artist himself, he had a few very intriguing comments to share with us.
What do you think is exclusive to Amsterdam? What do you think Amsterdam has brought, or like you is unique to Amsterdam's scene?
Well, this shop, basically.
Right? Yeah.
Where you guys right?
Yeah, exactly.
Are right now.
Exactly.
I don't know if you've been behind here at the Waterloo Square, the flea market.
Okay.
We got a stand there as well, where we sell spray paint. That is pretty unique in the world, actually.
Right.
I mean, yeah.
And you have local artists in the area coming through here, and this is the stop.
Yeah.
This is the
yeah.
place.
Yeah. This is the candy store for artists.
Right. Yeah. This place is great.
And not only from here, from Amsterdam, but from the whole country and from countries around us and from pretty much the whole world.
Have there been any movements where artists have been commissioned to do something on a space, or is it kind of just individually going out and finding spots to do art?
Both.
Sweet.
And not only artists from here, from Amsterdam, who get those commissions, but also from abroad, like a couple of, weeks, months ago. A lot of people from Brazil flew in to Amsterdam to paint these large surfaces, large walls, and that was a commission.
Yeah,
right. Yeah. Difference between graffiti or street art, if there exists a difference.
I think it's a big difference.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, graffiti is the origin of it all, and street art is a.
Interpretation or movement out of
pretty much
something that evolved from it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, it is. Yeah, And I think it's still two different things, and you have to look at it as two different things.
Given a few more days to explore Antwerp, we were able to discover the wide variety of art covering the city's spaces. While sprayed pieces, store coverings, and stencils continued the trends shown in previous stops, we found that Antwerp street art is unique because of two interesting developments. First, we noticed a substantial amount of animated murals, from abstract pieces to those dedicated to historical figures to others depicting an individual's representation of the city's culture. These spaces were clearly sanctioned to brighten the city's infrastructure and provide a higher degree of artistic freedom to local citizens.
We experienced the second special development in the Graffiti Rainforest, an area in Antwerp's outskirts where a variety of art crews were given an opportunity to display their passion and skills in 2009. This area provided a larger example of city beautification and the globalization of street art, as well as showing us a clear example of the difference between street art and graffiti. As the crews from Belgium and beyond improved the appearance of a downtrodden area, they were able to better their skills, advertise, and take steps in making names for themselves on a global scale. The clear distinction between graffiti and street art is apparent all over the walls, from the simple, hastily done tags to concentrated pieces of many different styles. The freedom given to the artists allowed some to create a form we hadn't seen in previous stops, detailed rendition of popular media icons. Surrounding these, we observed a variety of forms that would continue to be relevant in following stops. All in all, our experiences in Amsterdam and Antwerp reinforced the popularity of major styles, exemplified the culture's promotion of global interconnectedness through sanctioned projects, and highlighted the contribution that street art can have on city beautification.
A global feature in graffiti art is that it exists in high visibility areas. This is especially true in Paris, where graffiti is emblazoned on rooftops, on vans, and even on monuments.
This isn't a surprise. Many graffiti artists start by simply publicizing their names in the most visible places possible, to be seen and known. Consequently, a great deal of the graffiti artwork that exists in Paris is in the metro tunnels, where thousands of people a day catch glimpses of the overwhelming number of tags that have been created over the years. Like other cities, there are also enclaves or graffiti forests that exist in Paris. Street artists and graffiti crews who have worked all over the world have operated in this famous graffiti district of Belleville. Unlike other parts of Paris, graffiti art and street art are widely accepted in this area. Seemingly everyone on the street was creating a piece of art. Even these kids were honing their skills with a simple tag. But there was one artist who was creating a bigger mural, Meet Bach. He's an artist who's been active in France and internationally for about the last 10 years. I sat down for this unique opportunity to watch an artist create. Graffiti and vandalism to Bach are two different things. He described vandalism as a disorderly writing done by people who don't know what they're doing. While graffiti artwork is an artistic expression, usually characterized by murals like the one he's working on now. However, this begs the age-old question, what is art? Isn't it possible that Parisians might dismiss Bach's view of graffiti art as another form of large-scale vandalism? He seemed to acknowledge that view, and he had this to say.
A nice tag, you know, in the street, I would probably like it, but then a normal person would hate it, see it as a vandalism, and fair enough.
Graffiti artists have made the Metro Tunnels their collective art studio, one of the few places their work won't be erased due to public disapproval. However, some types of public art are widely accepted in Paris.
They love it when it's figurative, when it represents something, when they can access it, basically. They love it when they love stencils and these kind of things, so they love everything that they can understand, basically.
Like other artists we spoke to, Bach made a clear distinction between graffiti art and street art.
He saw graffiti art as a style that would appeal mostly to the people that were involved in the scene, while street art can appeal to a broader audience. Paris taught us that graffiti is a complicated calligraphy in which artists paint pictures with their letters.
Argentinian street art, notably in La Boca, is used to distinguish concurrent artwork within a cityscape from vandalism, regional graffiti, and corporate art. The city of Buenos Aires has become an acclaimed street art city in which renowned artists come to confront their skill by situating non-art conditions. Street artists ordinarily do not aspire to transform the definition of an artwork, but rather to question the existing surroundings with their own visualization. This is overwhelmingly evident in Buenos Aires as they aim to have their work convey politically relevant expression such as the military dictatorship of the late 70s to early 80s and the Dirty War. Artists communicate this in various ways that are enlightened by aesthetic mediums without being entrapped by them. A substantial amount of the street art in Buenos Aires is also in response to the financial crisis of the early 2000s, in which one out of every five people were unemployed. Much of this street art from this time is polychromatic, amusing, and lively, in order to enhance the frame of mind of those struggling during this time.
In Brazil, the forms of street art are mostly unsanctioned and supported by its community for their intricacy and cultural representations. Notable street artists from around the world travel to places like Rio de Janeiro to experiment with radiant colors and expose their work to larger populations. The animations of various types of citizens works to enhance the city's pride. The creation of abstract creatures promotes imagination in the passerby. Brazilian street art is also known for its distinct tagging and hard-to-reach places. We saw a large concentration of pieces in the Lapa district, known primarily for samba dancing and its famous mosaic steps. We noticed that various pieces in the area focus on Rio's passion for this dance and serve to display the dancing culture to visitors. Santa Teresa's mosaic steps represent a more uncommon form of street art that we coincidentally discovered in Buenos Aires. The steps are decorated with an expansive collection of flags and memoirs from areas all over the world, and are often visited by citizens hoping to see their city or country's representation. As noted on the author's description, people anywhere in the world can send in tile design and have the chance to be included in the constantly changing collection. The stairway is another powerful example of the connection that art can create among distant populations, especially when implemented in a city that is so popular on an international scale.
For one final opinion on the difference between street art and graffiti, we asked Professor Faye Serio.
When I think of graffiti, I go back to the 70s when graffiti was stylized words and sayings or themes. Street art for me is something that is visually colorful, interpretive as to some sort of theme or some sort of scene or some sort of portrait that is painted large scale.
Through this project, we learned that street art and graffiti are complementary but separate entities. Street art was born out of graffiti and has evolved into the style that exists independently. There's a globalizing trend in both street art and graffiti that's a result of artists spreading their styles, techniques, and ideas around the world, all the while learning from other artists they interact with. Our final conclusion is that street art is an accessible style to the general public, while graffiti continues to be used as a message within closed communities. ¶¶
dark gray at the bottom of the wall, light brown in the background, 20 stories tall, blue and orange for the welcoming, letters on the drawer, need another can of brown and a yellow for the star, use that for the awning, save some for the morning, put it above the buildings but shade it to show the dawning, white tea corners with blue and whites upon them, brown paper stash and gray sewer support them, purple tops is down, purple pouches a crown, black leather Bibles, gold robes and gowns, green and white dice games, charcoal calibers, silver hops out in burgundy the parameter, running through burgundy cans, I can't keep one, try painting the high ups but I can't see none, red and black J.O.'s, hands on the paper.